We need to get to it. Let's turn in our Bibles to Isaiah 64. We're looking at Isaiah 64 and 65. Title of our study, Prayers, Praises, and Promises. Three P's tonight, prayers, praises, and promises. And these three P's permeate the scriptures. Those we consider tonight actually began back in Isaiah 63, verse 7. So there's a series of prayers and petitions, perhaps a couple promises that began back there. I know it's odd to break a passage up like that. They did it in the chapters. I did it for more practical reasons. I don't really know why they did it. I did it because we were sharing in communion, and I just wanted to make sure we had plenty of time for that. So tonight, we pick up at Isaiah 64, but I'm letting you know, later, if you want to get the entire context of this particular section, you would go back, which we don't have time for, to Isaiah 63, verse 7. Well, Isaiah 64, 1 begins with a petition. Oh, that you would rend the heavens, that you would come down, that the mountains might shake at your presence as fire burns brushwood, as fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations may tremble at your presence. Interesting side note, won't make any difference to you practically, but if you're a Bible student, and I know you are because it's Wednesday night, what else would draw you, right? It's like your heater's broke or your TV doesn't work. And so, no, you're here because you love to study the Bible. I know that. Well, listen, Isaiah 64, 1 in the original Hebrew text, well, not the original because there were no, you know, verses and chapters and all that, but when they actually did the Hebrew text, it was Isaiah 63, verse 20. As far as how did it end up being 64, 1 in our Bibles, I have no idea. And I'm not all that interested in finding out, or I could have researched and told you. But the point is, there are those little things. So when people start telling you, oh, the Bible's so hard to understand and it's all filled with errors, and you can say, yeah, I know what you mean. I just found out there's one verse where the, you know, in one Bible it says it's in this, it's one verse back, and in the other it's in the next chapter. It's not really an issue, is it? That's the kind of mistakes that actually might be, but I'm certain it's not even a mistake anyway. They had a reason for it. I'm just clueless as to what that might be. Well, 63:15 then, he's saying, look down from heaven. And the New Living Translation, I really like this, of 64:1. He's saying, oh, that you would burst forth from the heavens and come down. So Isaiah 63:15, look down. Isaiah 64:1, come down. It's kind of good. He's saying, hey, check out what's happening. And then it's like, okay, now that you've seen it, would you mind getting down here and doing something about it? That's the heart of it, you see. How the mountains would quake in your presence as fire causes wood to burn and water to boil. Your coming would make the nations tremble. Then your enemies would learn the reason for your fame. You should know that after God brought Israel out of Egypt as they were heading on their way to ultimately the battle at Jericho, the people in Jericho had all heard what had transpired back in Egypt. They knew these guys came out after a series of notable and devastating plagues, and that God brought them out with a strong hand. And though the children of Israel faltered, they failed to walk by faith, they ended up spending 40 years in the wilderness unnecessarily. Why? Well, God's promise was to take them in and go before them. And not only that, the people they feared most feared them even more. And we know that because 40 years later, when they prepare to actually go in, they send those spies, and Rahab speaks about the situation and the fear the people had there. We actually touched on her in our first of a three-part series this past weekend, in case you weren't with us. It's Christmas, the rest of the story. We looked at the family of God and Jesus' genealogy. This week we'll do part two, and we're going to look at John the Baptist. And next week we'll look at Jesus' birth and the situation that surrounded it. But all of that to say this. He's saying, if you'd just come down here and do something, the nations would quake. They were quaking even at what he'd done in the past. So the desire, by the way, of the faithful remnant in every generation has been the same. God, look down on us. Take note of us. Pay attention to what we're going through. And he always has, and he always does, and he always will. But also, come down. Lord, show yourself strong. The pleas of verses 1 and 2 are supported by the memory of and the praise for God's past interventions on their behalf. He says in verse 3, when you did awesome things for which we did not look. I like that phrase. He's saying we didn't even expect it. We had no idea you were going to do it. Could you do that again? Now that you've done it, when you did awesome things for which we did not look, you came down. The mountain shook at your presence. I like to suggest God's best, his best works, his greatest plans are often totally unexpected and unprecedented. And the reason for that is because no one thinks like God. The more we study and the more we obey, the more we begin to think like him. But we saw it in Isaiah not that far back, not that long ago. Isaiah 55, he said, my thoughts are not your thoughts. It was verse 8. My ways are not your ways, says the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. I love that. He's basically just reminding us that we don't need to figure him out or map out how he works. He works in unexpected and unprecedented ways. You know, in the book of Acts, when the fire fell and the whirlwind, you know, wind was passing through, and those in the upper room began to speak in unknown tongues, languages unknown to them, the languages of the people who were on the streets below. They heard them above magnifying the wonderful works of God and the wonderful God of those works. But here's the point. They had no idea that was going to happen. He just, having told them to go and make disciples of all the nations, he said, wait a minute, wait. No, wait. Go, yeah, wait. And I think it kind of can, you know, make you, okay, do we go or do we wait? You go and first you wait. Because wait for what? Until the Holy Spirit comes upon you. He was saying, don't go in your own strength. Don't go in your own power. Don't go without me. But once the Holy Spirit comes upon you, he said, you'll be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world. And that's exactly what took place. But do you know that after that, there were a couple other times in Scripture where a similar situation took place, but in each of those, it was totally unexpected again. It's not like they're sitting there and think, well, maybe he's going to do what he did back. They weren't thinking like that. They were just saying, okay, Lord, what are you going to do? Or sometimes they would just be in a place and he'd do something. And they say, wow, this is just like that. What I'm saying and encouraging you not to do is try to get God to do anything. Just say, Lord, here I am. Use me. Here I am. Change me. Here I am. Lord, I just want to be your man. Or if you're a gal, I just want to be your woman. Well, for since the beginning of the world, verse 4, men have not heard nor perceived by the ear, nor has the eye seen any God besides you who acts for the one who waits for him. See, there it is. He's just saying, hey, we wait on him. Blessed is the one who does. Those who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength, mount up on eagle's wings. It's glorious to just sit at the feet of our Lord spiritually as we open his word and as we pray and say, Lord, just speak to me. You're not telling them what to do. You're just saying, Lord, I really do want to hear from you. We saw it in Psalm 115 and again in Psalm 135. Men's idols are silver and gold. That's what they were making them of back then. That's what they make them of now. They were made in the image of men because they were made by mere men. And because, well, men made the idols, they gave them mouths and eyes and ears and noses and hands and feet, but unfortunately couldn't speak or see or hear or smell or handle or walk. And then he concludes that section where he's saying such things, saying those who make them are like them. So is everyone who trusts in them. Here he's simply saying, hey, no one's ever seen any God besides you. And the reason for that, you're already aware. There is no God besides him. So they make their gods and they worship their gods, but they're not, their gods are small g. We're worshiping big G. We got the real guy, right? Well, you meet him, verse 5, who rejoices and does righteousness, who remembers you in all your ways. You are angry, for we have sinned, and in these ways we continue and need to be saved. Listen, it's good to confess our sin. As New Testament Christians, we're aware. John tells us, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. But confess means more than to say, okay, you got me. All right, I did it. To confess is to say what God says about it. It's to, in essence, agree with God. He says the wages of sin is death. So when I confess that I've sinned, I'm saying, Lord, I don't die spiritually when I sin, or I'd be constantly dead and alive and dead and alive, and that would be awkward for God and for me. But what does happen is I break fellowship immediately. And you know this relationally. If you're married and you sin against your wife or she sins against you, there is an immediate break in fellowship. Oh, there's still conversation and there's still attitude, but usually not the conversation or attitude that brings joy to either of your hearts. And so the only way to get that right is to confess. Hey, it's my fault. You know, forgive me. Hey, three words every guy needs to learn. If you're married and you don't know these, hey, write it down, make a sign, put it everywhere you go. I was wrong. Now, I know some of you are like, but what about when I'm not wrong? Still works. I was wrong. Forgive me. I was wrong. Why? Because here's what I've learned and am still learning. Even if I'm right, the attitude that, well, I'm not gonna do anything until you apologize to me, that's wrong. If you have something against someone, you're supposed to go to them. If they have something against you, you're supposed to go to them. He always puts the ball in your court. And so to be able to come and say, and that's what's happening here. The problem here is simple. They were confessing, but they hadn't repented. And that's required for forgiveness. Some people actually think all I have to do is say, hey, I'm sorry to God, and then just keep doing the thing you say you're sorry for. Hey, we don't even believe that as parents, do we? Or grandparents? We taught our grandsons early on, you hurt each other, you say you're sorry. But we weren't really planning for the time when they'd stand right in front of us, one would punch the other, look at us and say, I'm sorry. Well, that's not what we had in mind, you see. We were talking about when you do it accidentally, you say you're sorry, not you do it and then you look at us and listen, if that can happen, is that not what we're guilty of when we're like, oh God, please forgive me. Get me out of this. I don't want to suffer the consequences of this, is what we're really saying. Not so much as I'm sorry for my sin and breaking fellowship and misrepresenting you, defiling myself, all those things and more, but God, I just don't want to suffer. And here's a tip. If you don't want to suffer for sin, stop sinning. Now, I know you can't all the way. I'm not pointing the finger like that, right? I mean, you know that old saying, you point one, you got three coming back at you, right? But what I am saying is there are things we do, and then we're sorry for them, but we do them again. And we're sorry for them, and we do them again. And at some point, we need to come to grips with the fact that we really can repent, and God really will give us power to overcome those things. That's an absolute, you see. Well, anyway, hey, yeah. If that's for me, I can't talk right now. I mean, I am talking right now, but I'm busy. So anyway, good to confess our sin. They didn't repent, which is absolutely required for forgiveness. Now, verse 6 and 7, so important. It's not an excuse for sin, but a recognition, an acknowledgement that they're sinners by nature and actions. Take a look. He says, but we are like an unclean thing. Unclean, defiled. That means unfit for worship, unfit for worship, unfit for service. And that's inherently born that way. And so those little angels, and they act like it for a little bit. And then they act like us. And so the thing is, it might be you tonight. You might realize, I'm unclean. I need to repent. I need to be cleansed by the word tonight. And he says, all our righteousnesses. Is that not a weird word? It's literally righteousnesses. Well, they're like filthy rags. That's because none are righteous. And our best works are still tainted by our sin. It's not like we can't do anything right. We can. We please our Lord. We bless people in His name. But everything we do, none of it can change the fact that by nature and act, we're still sinners. And if you're like, yeah, but you know, I don't do the really bad sins. I was thinking about the arsenic diet. Not that I'd ever go on it, and certainly hope Pam never puts me on it, because I wouldn't know. But, you know, it's like, how much arsenic would you be, you know, well, how much arsenic would be safe to put into the stew before you'd say, I'm not eating that stew, you know? And for me, the answer is any, right? I don't know how much arsenic takes to really mess you up, but I don't want any. And can I suggest sin is like arsenic? So we're thinking, well, you know, I don't sin as bad as he does or she does or they do, but sin kills. Sin defiles. And so he says, we're all like an unclean thing. All our righteousnesses are like filthy rags, and it's worse than that. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. That's the guilt, by the way, iniquities, and the consequences. And then he says, and there's no one who calls on your name, who stirs himself up to take hold of you. For you've hidden your face from us and have consumed us because of our iniquities. Now, verses 8 through 11 remind us that this section of Isaiah is post-captivity. When we started our study of Isaiah, they'd not gone into captivity yet. Now it's getting near the latter part of the captivity. And that's important because prior to the captivity, he's warning them, hey, it's going to happen. And the people are saying, nah, it's not going to happen. And now he's saying, hey, hang in there. God's going to bless you again. And people are saying, no, that's not going to happen. The same people that doubted in the beginning are still doubting. But verse 8 says, but now, O Lord, you are our Father. Father, that's relationship, right? This is the faithful remnant recalling the nature of their relationship. And we saw it last time. I think there was a time, I'm certain that I've shared it, that I actually thought, Father, that's a New Testament concept. But it's throughout the Scripture. Just like the New Testament, the bride of Christ, but Israel's the wife of Yahweh. And we're the bride of Christ. Well, he says, we are, latter part of verse 8, we are the clay, and you are our potter. You are potter, and we are the work of your hand, formed by him, formed for him, formed in the womb, transformed now. Well, do not be furious, the prayer, O Lord, nor remember iniquity forever. Indeed, please look, we are all your people. Note the transition here. Father speaks of intimacy and family because, you know, you're our Father, and then Lord speaks of responsibility. That's important. He's Lord, we're his servants. As his servants, our primary job is to find out what the Master wants us to do at any given time. Your people just reminds us family, you know, working together, serving together corporately. Your holy cities, verse 10, are a wilderness. Zion is a wilderness. Jerusalem, a desolation. Our holy and beautiful temple where our fathers praised you is burned up with fire. Clearly, we're post the, you know, the devastation and post the capture of the people, and they're taken to Babylon. But he says, all our pleasant things are laid waste. Will you restrain yourself because of these things, O Lord? Will you hold your peace and afflict us very severely? The answer, by the way, is he had. He had judged them, and it had been severe. He brought the enemy against them. He didn't just let them come. He drew them. They were his representatives, his sword, his ambassadors. Now they go overboard, and God judges and punishes the Babylonians for that. But don't miss it. God brought them to judge his oh-so-rebellious and unrepentant people. So the question here isn't, well, would he do such a thing? He had, but how long would it continue? The answer, by the way, Daniel 9:2, 70 years. It's not the only place, but Daniel's reading and he's coming to grips with the fact that, hey, this 70 years is almost up. Then there's the 77s of Daniel 9:24, and that's another thing altogether. That's to wrap up this whole season and bring about everlasting righteousness. Well, Isaiah 65:1 says, I was sought by those who did not ask for me. I was found by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am to a nation that was not called by my name. Here's an irony. It almost sounds like he's talking about the Gentiles here. He's actually talking about his own people. They stopped seeking him. They stopped looking for him. They stopped pleading with him. They turned from him to idols. They were faithless and unfaithful, but what we see is he continued to pursue them. I've stretched out my hands, he says in verse 2, all day long, to a rebellious people who walk in a way that is not good according to their own thoughts. When we go through our survey of the entire Bible in about, 14, 15 month period, beginning mid-January, I think I mentioned that to you, Book of Judges, the theme is this: every man did what was right in his own eyes. And I want to say that whole thing that's so popular today of you have your, you know, your values and I have mine, and you have, you know, your opinions and I have mine, and you know, listen, there's right and wrong, there's good and evil, there's light and darkness, there's truth and deception. And when every man does what's right in his own eyes, you know what you end up with? Chaos and confusion, suffering for the people, even the people of God. So verse 3 says, a people who provoke me to anger continually to my face, who sacrifice in gardens and burn incense on altars of brick, who sit among the graves and spend the night in the tombs, who eat swine's flesh and the broth of abominable things, it's in their vessels. Listen, he's saying they offered sacrifices to idols. In a word, idolatry. They sought counsel from the dead. That couldn't be stranger. They hung out in graveyards and sought wisdom from the perished. That's stupidity. They ate foods forbidden to them in spite of all their sin and disobedience. Here's the crazy thing. They were still self-righteous and haughty. And God hates both. Who say, verse 5, take note of it. Keep to yourselves. Do not come near me, for I am holier than you. He's saying, in spite of all their sin, in spite of their rebellion to him, their disobedience and their unrepentant hearts, they looked at the Gentiles around them and judged them as being unworthy. Wow, I'm holier than you. Do you know that this wasn't just going on back then? It was still happening in Jesus' day. It still happens today. We had an experience, one of my first trips, I think it was my very first trip now that I think of it, to Israel. I was with a group of pastors. One of the funnest things I ever did, travel with like a dozen crazy Calvary pastors. Well, they weren't all crazy. There were one or two that were actually sane. The rest were like me. And we're walking on the streets one night and we see a rabbi coming toward us and we're like, oh, this is cool. I've got a question or two for this guy. He sees us. It's obvious we're not Jewish, right? And he crosses the street. And I'm like, I'm looking at one of the guys with me and he goes, you know why he did that? And I'm like, yeah, I'm a Bible teacher. I actually didn't know. I wasn't processing it at the moment, but you know how us guys are. And so he goes, yeah, exactly. It's because if he bumps into us, that will defile him. And he'll have to go home, take off his clothes, and go through all the ceremonial washing and stuff before he can get there to do his gig. So he's looking at us. We're there in the land of our Lord, loving on this. Man, we love the city of Jerusalem. We love the Word of God. We love the God and God the Son, and we even love them, the Jews. But they're looking and thinking, man, you don't want to bump into people like that. Something might spill on you. Yeah, the love we have for them. Well, anyway, they're just saying, you know, what they're saying, what they said. Don't come near. I'm holier than you. These are smoke in my nostrils, a fire that burns all the day. And I shouldn't stop mid-sentence because it's harder to find your place after, right? Behold, verse 6, it is written before me, I will not keep silence, but will repay, even repay into their bosom your iniquities in the iniquities of your fathers together, says the Lord, who have burned incense on the mountains, and blaspheme me on the hills. Therefore, I will measure their former work into their bosom. What he is reminding us of and reminding them of is that he always judges sin. He disciplines the repentant and he destroys the unrepentant. So since we're all sinners and we've all sinned, I'd want to make sure I'm in that repentant group and you too. That we never get to the place where we're just hardening our heart against the Lord and saying, hey, he'll cover it, he'll forgive it. Well, I wouldn't want to risk it, you see. Verses 8 through 12, God makes some promises. I titled this Prayers and Praises and Promises. It's important to note, most, if not all, of the promises here are God's promises. Now, I'm not against us making promises, but Jesus said it's not a great idea. When did he say that? He said, hey, it's better not to make an oath at all. If you make an oath, a promise, you have to keep it. And so don't make an oath, he says. Just let your yes be yes and your no be no. Whatever's more than this is going to be sin. So when I say I'm not really against making promises, not if you're sure you can keep them, you know. Unless you're absolutely certain, don't promise. Just say, God, strengthen me to do what you've called me to do, to be who you've called me to be. Strengthen me. Show me your will and then empower me to walk in it. But don't just promise, I'll never do that again. or I'll always do this from now on. Those just doom us to failure. Well, thus says the Lord, verse 8, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one says, do not destroy it, for a blessing is in it. So I will do for my servant's sake that I may not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob and from Judah, an heir of my mountains. My elect shall inherit it, and my servant shall dwell there. Get it? He's talking about that faithful remnant, his elect, his servants, descendants from Jacob. Jacob is Israel, right? So he's saying descendants from all Israel and from Judah. That's the southern tribes. That's those who settled there and were not a part of that Assyrian captivity earlier on, but were taken to Babylon. Well, he's saying, I'm going to bless both. I'm going to restore both. My elect, my servants, will dwell there. And his promises to them remind us we were chosen before the foundation of the world, that we'd be holy and blameless before him in love. He didn't just choose us. He chose us with a purpose to transform us, to make us the people he always intended us to be. Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for herds to lie down, for my people who have sought me. You know, during this time, Daniel, Isaiah, others, we'll look at Jeremiah, we'll look at Ezekiel, we'll look at the other minor prophets, some of them prior to, others of them after, but all of them, they sought him in a time where God's people weren't. And so we want to be like them. In a time where America's like moving the other direction, we want to be moving toward God. We want to be pressing in to him. And he says, you are those who forsake the Lord, who forget my holy mountain. Verse 11, who prepare a table for Gad and furnish a drink offering for many. Now, listen, that Gad means fortune, and that many or Meni means destiny. So what they're doing is they're looking for, again, a future fortune and destiny and offering to them when all of that's wrapped up in him. Therefore, he says, I will number you for the sword, and you shall all bow down to the slaughter, because when I called you, you did not answer. Or when I called, you did not answer. When I spoke, you did not hear, but did evil before my eyes, and chose that in which I do not delight. Therefore, thus says the Lord God. And listen, in Deuteronomy, he laid it out for them. Not the only place, but one where he did it so clearly. Blessings for obedience, curses for disobedience. He's saying, here's what's coming. Based on their response to him. My servants shall eat, but you will be hungry. My servants shall drink, but you will be thirsty. Behold, my servant shall rejoice, but you shall be ashamed. Behold, my servant shall sing for joy of heart, but you shall cry for sorrow of heart and wail for grief of spirit. You shall leave your name as a curse to my chosen, for the Lord God will slay you and call his servants by another name. He's separating out those who said they were of Israel and those who were actually governed by God. That's what Israel means, you see. Just like, you know, we call ourselves Christians, it's supposed to mean like Christ, followers of, representatives of, people like Christ. So my servants will eat, but you will be hungry. Jesus poses the question at one point saying, why do you say Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? That's actually a really good question. If we're his servants, we call him Lord, and he's saying, hey, don't do that, but we do it. Or he says, do this, and we don't. He's saying, why do you keep saying, Lord, Lord, if you're not going to act as if it was true? My servant shall drink, but you shall be thirsty. Many will say, Lord, Lord, our Lord says, in that day, didn't we do all these wondrous works for you? And he'll say, hey, I never knew you. If you've pondered him saying that to people who are saying, Lord, Lord, to him, well, they know him. How can he not know them? He means in that relationship. See, you could call me boss, and I would know you didn't work here, because everybody who works here knows I'm not their boss. I don't hire and I don't fire. And hey, look, pastor, that's my role here, not boss. I'm not the chief administrative officer, or am I? But I don't know, because I don't function and think like that. Well, what I'm saying is, if you did work here and I said, hey, you need to do your job, and you're like, who are you? You'd find out. And so, but again, probably that would be you and Bud, not you and me, or you and Quentin and not you and me, or you and somebody, because again, you know, if you're not doing what you want to do, that's a biblical issue to me, not an employment issue. I don't think like an employer. I think like a pastor. And so if you're not doing right, do right. Hey, say that to everybody, right? So wherever you work, your boss can thank me for this tonight. So my servants will rejoice, but you shall be ashamed. All who turned to and trusted in him were going to be rejoicing in the day he judged, because he's just judging the unrepentant. He's separating the wheat from the chaff. And he says, again, you'll leave your name as a curse to my chosen, for the Lord will slay you. Last verse we read, verse 15, and call his servants by another name. Now, is it just me, or does serving him seem like the better option here, right? Because he's just saying there's either rebel and suffer or obey and experience the blessings of obedience. So he that blesses himself in the earth, verse 16, shall bless himself in the God of truth. He who swears in the earth shall swear by the God of truth, because the former troubles are forgotten and because they are hidden from my eyes. God goes on to describe life on earth here in the millennium, yet ahead for us, as we experience his creation as he intended it. He uses the same words that he introduces the subject of the millennium here to describe the world we'll inherit after the millennium, after Satan's been bound for 1,000 years, after he's been released for a short season, after he is sent to Gehenna from which we will never hear, after which we will never hear from him again. He says it in verse 17 here, behold, I create a new heavens and a new earth. And the former shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem as a rejoicing, and her people as a joy. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and joy in my people. The voice of weeping shall no longer be heard in her, nor the voice of crying. Now, verse 20 provides some of the reasons we know he's talking about the millennium and not the eternal state. So if you were confused at all by the fact that he's saying, I create a new heavens and a new earth, that's what he tells us in Revelation 21. Revelation 20 is the millennium. But look at verse 20. Just worked out that way. 2020. That's perfect vision, right? No more shall an infant from there live but a few days, nor an old man who has not fulfilled his days. The child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. Get this. In the millennium, some people will continue to sin. Now, that won't be you, because we'll be in glorified bodies. We'll be beyond that. Some people think they're beyond it now. I assure you no one is. But in that day, we will be perfected and we'll be returning to rule and reign with him for that 1,000 years upon the earth. But if a child can live to 100 and die, we're not in the eternal state, because in the eternal state, I'll read it to you. I'll read it to you. Listen, those who enter into the millennium will live They'll die. They'll experience the best world that can be, those who enter into the millennium in their own natural bodies. And if you're thinking, how could anybody survive the tribulation and enter in? Some will. And then they'll have children and they'll be living in a perfect environment. So I think there'll be a lot of children. But here's what we know for sure. While the millennium includes an extension of a lifespan for them in the eternal state, there's no more death. There's no more sin. There's no more sinners. Revelation 21:4, listen carefully. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying, no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Revelation 21:8, the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. None of them will be in the eternal state, in the New Jerusalem, in the everlasting kingdom of our Lord. They will be with Satan, with the Antichrist, with this false prophet, with everyone who ever rejected the Lord. They, verse 21 here, shall build houses and inhabit them. We're still in the millennium here, right? I just took you ahead, but now we're back. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. That was happening to them, remember, at this time. They'll not plant and another eat. For as the days of a tree, so shall be the days of my people. And my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, nor bring forth children for trouble. For they shall be descendants of the blessed of the Lord and their offspring with them. Remember, these words were first spoken and penned for God's rebellious people who, because of their sin, had either been dispersed by the Assyrians or captured by the Babylonians. And a secondary application belongs to Israel today. Those who are scattered or regathered. We don't know when all these things will occur, but we have his word that they will. Once more, we have our marching orders until they do. Matthew 28:19 says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Listen, that was their marching orders, those first disciples and apostles. Those are our marching orders. He doesn't have a new plan to reach the world. We go out individually. We begin at home, our Jerusalem. Then we succeed here. We move to our Judea, then to Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the world. It's why we send people out. It's why, as much as I hate to see Justin and Lisa move to Kenya, I rejoice in helping to send them to Kenya. Why do I hate it? Because I love working with them. Because they've been a joy to see the fruit they've produced here. But what's going to happen there? More fruit. And in a place where there are far less of us than we have here. There were thousands and thousands of Bible-teaching churches in the United States. There are hundreds of churches just in Chico. And I don't know how many teach through the Bible or how many even teach from the Bible, but I do know this. Justin does that. Man, they are getting gold when he moves there. And so we really are sending one of our best, and we're expecting God to raise up. He's been faithful in the past. We're thinking, okay, we send our best. He'll raise up 4 like him or 10. He's not an adder. He's a multiplier. I'm looking forward to seeing him do that. Well, verse 24, so we can have a little extended time for worship. It shall come to pass that before they call, I will answer. And while they're still speaking, I will hear. It reminded me of something Jesus said regarding our prayers. When you pray, he said, don't use vain repetitions like the heathen do. Thinking they think they'll be heard for their many words. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask. So he's saying here, it'll come to pass before they call, I'll answer. You know, you pick up the phone to make a call and the person you're trying to call is on the phone. That's what he's saying it's going to be like. While they're still speaking, I will hear. The Lord's Prayer, by the way, follows that exhortation by our Lord not to get involved in vain repetition, saying the same thing over and over mindlessly, thinking somehow that's connecting you with him and blessing him and pleasing him. But he gives us the Lord's Prayer right on the heels of that. And elsewhere he says, ask and seek and knock and keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking with the promise that, hey, you're going to get a response in every case from him. Verse 25 says, the wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, and dust shall be the serpent's food, and they shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, says the Lord. He's telling us in that day, defenseless animals will be safe in the presence of former predators, including leopards and lions and bears. And if you're like, I don't see lions and leopards and bears, Isaiah 11:9, let me read it to you. They shall not hurt nor destroy in my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. In that day there shall be a root of Jesse who shall stand as a banner to the people. For the Gentiles shall seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious. I know I didn't read you the lions and tigers and bears. Oh, that's Wizard of Oz. It's there. You go look later. I jotted something far more important. They won't hurt, not them, none of them in my holy mountain. The earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord. What a day that will be. No man will teach his brother saying, know the Lord, for everyone will know the Lord. What a day that will be. A root of Jesse, that's our Lord, standing as a banner to the people. The Gentiles will seek him, that's us. And his resting place shall be glorious. We say amen. And even so, Lord, come quickly. We know why he's waiting. And if you're not yet born again of the Spirit of God, if you've never confessed and turned from your sin, for that's what repentance means, you don't keep going that way, you change direction, you stop thinking like that, you stop living like that, you live for him, you surrender to him, you don't just say what you're doing is wrong, you say, God, forgive me of it and strengthen me not to go back to it. Listen, we know he's waiting for you. If you're not in Christ, he's waiting for you. And we're so grateful he waited for us, that he didn't come back and take the church to be with him when we would have been left here to endure the tribulation and you know, hopefully somehow survive it and come to faith in him in it. No, we're so grateful that he saved us, and we want to see you have the same experience. Lord, we thank you for every person you've drawn. So grateful for the 3+ decades now of ministering your word, just opening your holy life-transforming word, trusting that, Lord, as it goes forth, you're going to accomplish what you promised you will, what you're intending to do. I don't even always know what that'll be, Lord. Probably more often than not, I don't really know what you're up to, but I know your word is true, and I know that it cleanses, and I know that it challenges, and I know that it corrects, and I know that it redirects. I know that it nourishes. I know, Lord, it refreshes. Your word, how amazing and awesome it is, and how amazing and awesome you are. And we unite in prayer. If there'd be any or many tonight who never said it, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Forgive me for going my own way, for doing my own thing, for thinking somehow I could make myself acceptable to you. If it's true, and it must be, our righteousness is as filthy rags. My best works, my best efforts still fall short, because they're offered by a guilty sinner. Well, Lord, cleanse me and forgive me tonight. Hey, we can pray that, Lord. We're also asking that you would clearly speak to any and all who've never said yes to you. And if that's you tonight and you know it, listen, the day I gave my life to the Lord, I had a very similar invitation. Come to Christ, receive his forgiveness, give your life to the one who gave his life for you. I went forward, I gave my life to him, and I have not looked back. I have no regrets except that I didn't do it sooner. And if you've never given your life to him, I'm asking you tonight, do it tonight. Don't leave this place still dead in trespasses and sin, for that's your current state unless you're born again and in him. And if you're like, I don't understand those words, born again, well, understand this, you're dead spiritually or you're alive spiritually. And if you're not in Christ and Christ isn't in you, you're dead. And if you don't come to faith in him, you will die in your sin, forever be separated from him. That's the bad news. The good news, he'll forgive you right now if you'll ask him to do that. If that's your need, I'd ask you to raise your hand, hold it high. Allow me the great privilege of introducing you to the one who made you and loves you and gave his life for you. Anyone this hour, anyone this evening, this service. We are in awe of you, Lord, amazed by you. We pray that this season, this Christmas, you really will be at the forefront. Keep us from getting caught up in all the periphery. Lord, as people debate and discuss all these issues, help us to focus on you and to love on you and to share you. And we thank you for the opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, let